Today we will improve our multi-layer perceptron to have a flexible number of layer and neurons. This is built on last week's video where we coded backpropagation from scratch. The code is divided into three classes. We have first the multi-layer perceptron class, which is where the main interface with the user is. We have the layer class, which will model the behavior between groups of neurons. And finally, we have the neuron class, where most of the action take place. If you prefer to follow on your own, click on the first link in my description for the notebook on GitHub. Right, so the setup looks like this. We want to learn the XOR function, which means one or the other, but not both. So this is our X and this is our Y. To do so, we set up our multilayer perceptron with two parameters, the learning rate and the max number of iteration for the training. Then we create the architecture of the network outside in. Here we have one output neuron, two hidden layer, each with three neurons inside. Finally, we train the network on the full dataset. If we run this, we should see the prediction 0110 for the data above because it's an XOR function. All right, so let's train that. Let's run this cell. Okay, so it's training for a while and we have zero error. So that means that it fitted completely this function. Let's look if the predictions are correct. Perfect, so we're good. This works. So let's dive into the first part, which is the multi-layer perceptron class. Right, so let's walk through the multi-layer perceptron class. So if you remember correctly, the way we're using this class is we use the constructor, put those parameters in, and then we're constructing the architecture outside in, so the output layer first, and then we go through the hidden layer. And here over there, we have those weird class, we have those weird functions which we're using to create this architecture. So here the init function is just normal, we're just putting the parameters over there. It's those functions that are a bit more mysterious. So if we're in the output layer, we're just creating that layer and putting it into our list. If we're in the hidden layer, we're gonna attach this hidden layer to the first one in the architecture. So this way we're gonna create the architecture outside in. So the output layer first and then the hidden layer. And then we put that in the layer in the first place of the layers list. So we have the predict function, which takes a row of data. And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna first shoot it through the first layers. And then we're gonna iteratively give that activation of this layer to through the other layer activation and then through the other layer activation over and over again. So by the end of this, the last layer is the output layer. So we're gonna have its activation and then we're gonna iterate through its activation to use the Heaviside step function to either give us a one or a zero depending on the threshold, which is at 0.5. So this will give us a classification of one or zero. The next function that matters is the fit function, where we have the table of feature and then the targets. And then what we're doing is two phases. The first phase is initializing the weights throughout all of the layers. So the number of weight will depend on the input that we get for the first layer. So this one, And then for the other one, the number of weight in this current layer depends on the previous layer number of input. So this is why we do it inside out. Then what we're doing over here is doing multiple rounds of stochastic gradient descent. If you don't know what it is, I have a video on that. And then once we get a random row from our data set, we look at the target and then we're gonna update the layers with that target. Here we have a big layer of abstraction because the backpropagation is happening over here. So if we're looking at update layers, we're taking the target over here and we're doing a backpropagation in two steps. First, we're calculating the new weights by going outside in. So we start at the output layer. We need to do that, otherwise the backpropagation doesn't really work. And here I say calculate the weight, not update the weight, because you first need to calculate the new weights, and then when you're ready and everyone has a new weight that they can now have, this is where you actually update them. So we need to do that, otherwise the first layer will be working with wrong weight for this forward pass. And once we have those new weights, this is where we're updating the weight. And if you look, we're actually using the neuron interface to calculate and to update. And that's it. This is the multi-layer perception class. There's not much to it because there's a big layer of abstraction. We're gonna demystify the rest of the code. So if we go into the layer class, every time we create a layer, what we're actually doing is iteratively create each of the neuron and then just appending that into the list. And this is what layer is. It's a list of neurons, and every other action will be to manipulate those neurons. If you remember correctly, we have the attach function over here, which we're doing when we're gonna create a new layer. So what we're doing here is we have our layer, which is us, and another layer. And for all of the neurons in this layer, what we're doing is we're attaching this neuron to the whole output layer over here. We need to do that in order to set up the weight, the output properly for each of the neurons. This is used for the backpropagation algorithm. Then we have here the init layer. So this is just a warp wrapper function around the neuron init weights, which will initialize all the weights, all the correct number of weights for this layer. So here, depending on the number of input that we give here, you will spawn in the right number of weights. Finally, we have the predict function that we're gonna use also in the predict function of the multi-layer perceptron. And what this thing is actually doing is we're appending a bias here, which we need to make the fitting better for the neural network. And then what we're doing is we're iterating over the neurons and predicting using this row of data. You see here it's like three level of predict. We have the neural network predict, which is calling each of the predict of each of the layer, and then each neuron is actually doing his own predict to generate an activation. The activation is what we give back to the neural network. So that's a layer. It's a nice wrapper function which help us modelize a group of neurons. Alright, so the bulk of the code sits in the neuron class. If you already saw my video about backpropagation, it's the same thing. It's just that we set up the layer so that we don't have to manually do the wiring and everything. Here, the layer class is controlling those group of neurons a bit more efficiently. Here we're using the delta method for the backpropagation. So attached to output, what it does is it set up the output neurons for the current neuron so that we can properly calculate the gradient for the backpropagation. So we have this list over here, and over there we're iterating over all of the neurons that were given, and we're gonna just append over here, which is totally useless. Yeah, actually I just realized we can refactor this to be just this. Ta-da. So this is doing the same thing. Okay, good. So here we're using a sigmoid function for the activation. So it's the simplest one. This is a bit hard-coded again because I'm using the derivative of the sigmoid inside the backpropagation for the calculate update. Here we're initialize the weight. So here we have init weight. Inside the init layer, we're initing the weights, and here this is what we're doing for each neuron. We're getting the number of input for this neuron, and then we're appending a random number between 0 and 1 for the weights. So depending on the number of input, we're gonna have this number of weight with this this range of values. Here the predict is pretty simple. We go through the feature and the weight for this particular neuron. So we give the feature row over here. So what we're doing over here is we're weighting each of the feature value by the weight that we currently have, so we turned on, and we're summing up all of this activation, and then we are gonna just put that activation over here on the sigmoid, and this will give us the output that we return. So here this is like doing a linear regression kind of, and here this is actually doing the non-linearity. Here there's the bias, right? Remember in the layer we did the plus one, and it's inside of here. So the very first thing over here will be the weight times one. So so we have the bias for there. So the next function that is important here is the calculate update function. So in the back propagation, 2 videos ago, I showed the derivation that we need to do in order to calculate the gradient for the stochastic gradient descent. Here, this is where we're doing. We're calculating it, and over there, we're updating it. So it's a two-step process. First, you calculate the new weights for this neuron, and then once the full network has new weights, then you go back through the full network, and then you replace those weights. If you don't do that, the problem is you will be calculating a gradient on a different weight than the forward pass was going through. So basically, we're using the delta rule. So here, this is how we calculate the delta for the output. So this is where we have this thing. And over here, this is how we calculate the delta for the hidden layer. We're doing a bunch of summation over here. So if you want to learn more about the delta method, you can go ahead and look at my previous video. So once we have the deltas, it's really, really simple what we need to do. We just need to do the delta times the current input. And that's pretty much it. So you keep in memory the input that we're given, and by keeping them, you can do this, which will calculate the gradient for all the hidden layers, and you can do this, the gradient descent. So this is the part where we're actually doing gradient descent. That's it. You store those weights, and when you're ready, you're gonna update them over here. That's it. It's a simple class. Once you get the hang of the delta method, it's the whole thing is super simple. So let's try it again just to see that it didn't break anything. Good, I didn't break. Right, so there we are. We can still train this thing properly. We have zero error over here, and everything seems to be working. If you have any question or comment, feel free to put them in the comment section, and have a nice week.